Getting up in the dark at 3 a.m. on a cold English morning was agony. I hated it. Never could seem to eat that early with a nervous stomach, so the fighter pilot's breakfast of coffee and a cigarette was standard. Then we'd head on over to the mission briefing to find out exactly where we were going and how many German fighters we could expect. After picking up helmet, chute, May West, and other equipment, we'd head out to the line. All of this would have been a horrible experience if it weren't for that wonderful P-51. When you got in the Mustang, it felt like you just strapped the wings on. You didn't feel like you had a fuselage around your body. You were a part of the airplane. I loved it more than any other plane I ever flew. I'll never
The North American P-51 Mustang, everybody's idea of a fighter plane. When World War II ended, there probably wasn't an American who didn't know what a Mustang was. And since then, pilots have dreamed of flying it, the ultimate flying machine. Sleek, with a Rolls-Royce Packard-built Merlin 1500 horsepower engine up front, a cockpit you pull on like a pair of pants instead of climbing into. When England was looking for fighters in 1940, it came with a shopping list to U.S. manufacturers. Happy with North American Aviation's Harvard trainers, the British ordered a new fighter from the company, which they named the Mustang, powered by an Allison engine. It was faster than anything else at low level. When the Rolls Merlin high-altitude engine was grafted onto the airframe, the finest all-around fighter of the war came into being, able to range deep into enemy territory and still handle enemy fighters. Without it, the 8th Air Force bomber campaign, which was almost stopped in 1943 by the Luftwaffe, would not have been able to carry on. Pilots knew they had a thoroughbred on their hands when they started flying this wild, spirited pony of the Old West. The last military Mustangs weren't retired until 1983, when the Dominican Republic sold theirs into the Civil War bird market. Everything about this airplane says flying. What was it someone said? If it looks right, it flies right. Ever since I was 3 years old, when my dad commanded a squadron of Mustangs, this was my idea of what airplanes look like. I guess I thought everyone's dad had a bunch of them and I wanted to fly one. That dream has come true in spades many times over, but the experience is a rare one among flyers since so few warbirds exist out of the 300,000 we made during World War II. That's why we're here today, to take you along, put you in the cockpit with me, and turn the horses loose. Thanks to Elmer Ward, owner of Man of War here, and his major Mustang parts company, Pioneer Aero, at Chino, California. The first thing most pilots ask, other than what's it like to fly a 51, is how do you get the training? It really doesn't differ much from World War II. Get a good amount of time in tailwheel type aircraft, such as the PT-17 Stearman, then as much as possible in the AT-6 Advanced Trainer, particularly a few hours from the back seat to get used to the lack of visibility forward on the ground. Once you can fly a T-6, you can fly any of the fighters, if you heed the second requirement. Memorize the pilot's operating handbook. Pilots who try to shortcut the handbook tell some sad tales. Whenever I'm away from the P-51 for a while, I get the handbook out the night before I'm supposed to fly, and I read it through. It's quite a surprise to find some things I'd forgotten. At 400 miles an hour, you can't afford to forget very much. There are also some fine dual-control Mustangs available for transition training, and these really help add safety to the process. The first thing we can do is jump up on the wing and check the cockpit to make sure battery, generator, and magneto switches are off and controls unlocked. Want to make sure that the battery and generator switches are off, the magneto switch off, and the control is unlocked. Then we'll come up here, check the hydraulic reservoir, make sure it basically has enough fluid in it, and we'll secure all that with a screwdriver. Then we're back up here to the oil level, has a regular stick on it, except this one says gallons, and it goes up to 12. Generally around 9 or 10 is plenty. Then we're back up to the front for the coolant levels. And there are two coolant levels, basically. You're checking the intercooler level at this point, and then up at the front of the nose, we check the general coolant in gallons. We should be all set. Off the left wing of the trailing edge, we'll continue the preflight by checking the fuel gas cap to make sure it's secure. And also, we check visually for the fuel level. Get the cap secured back on. Check the flaps for security and a little bit of freedom of movement. The flap actuating rod is at the base of the flap. We certainly want to check that. Walk over to the aileron, check for freedom of movement, and that the aileron gap seal is installed and fitting properly. This gives a great deal of effectiveness to the aileron. We don't want to fly without one. Onto the front of the airplane in the preflight, we want to check the gear strut here. Make sure we have 3.5 inches of inflation. Check the security of the landing gear fairing doors, the down lock pins, condition of the landing light, hydraulic actuators for leaks also from coolant pipes, general condition of the inside of the wheel well. These big fairing doors, which go up and down and streamline the airplane when the wheels go up, I want to check the inside of the intake scoop for the radiator and the oil radiator. And also, when we're here, we go ahead and drain a little bit of fuel out of the fuel tank sump to make sure there's no water in there. Up to the front of the airplane now, I want to check on the exhaust stacks and basically tinkle them with a screwdriver. If one of them funks, then it's cracked. And that tells you you're going to have to replace it. Up here to the front, I want to check the carburetor air scoop. Any creatures that might have crawled in during the night, you just want to make sure all this is clear for intake of the carburetor. General condition of the propeller, movement, security, and leading edge of the blades for nicks and things like that. Then down into the wheel well here on the right side, and the main thing here is the accumulator pressure on the hydraulic reservoir. It has to be at least 400 pounds of pressure. General condition of the well, back to strut inflation, security of the doors, on around to the tail. Back to the trailing edge of the right wing, we check the elevators here for the same condition we have on the other side. Security of the flap again, and the flap actuating rod here at the base of the flap. And back to the tail. Want to check the attachment on the elevators and freedom of movement. Condition of the elevator trim tab. Condition of the rudder and its trim tab as well. And the attach points. Back to the other elevator, its trim tab, attachment, and freedom of movement. Then over here to the tail wheel, we'll check tail wheel inflation and the strut inflation. And on up into the cockpit. I love the Mustang cockpit. Everything is easily within reach. It's organized for the pilot. Simple, really. And it's a lot like the T6. All the more reason to go master a T6 before you come out to fly a Mustang. Let's do the before start checklist. We'll go through that left to right. Flaps up. Carburetor ram air. Carburetor heat in normal. Coolant doors open and in manual. Rudder trim 6 degrees right. Aileron trim 0, elevator trim 0, throttle cracked 1 inch, mixture and idle cutoff, propeller full forward, throttle friction set, magnetos off, supercharger in low, fuel set on the left tank because the carburetor return line puts about 10 gallons an hour back into the left tank when you fly, and the fairing door release in. Ready for start.
The only thing to watch for on startup is overpriming, which can cause a very exciting exhaust stack fire. In other words, too much fuel gets in the prime system and the exhaust fills up raw gas and all of a sudden the flames start coming out of there. The only thing you can do when that happens is keep it cranking and it'll eventually start. It's just an over fuel problem or too much gas in the system, too rich is what you call it. start up eventually. And if you don't, of course, then you just have fire all over the place. So you keep it cranking. Ready? My adrenaline's pumping. Every time I fiddle with the switches, I get my adrenaline up. So here we go. Battery and generator on. Fuel boost pump on. Check fuel pressure. Right up to normal. And how a Mustang pilot is expected to start one of these things without four hands, I never know, but we're going to give her a good try. Engage the starter, and we'll go six blades. Here we go.
Destroyed an aircraft on my first mission. Unfortunately, it was a P-51. I was taking off my leader's wing when I blew a tire and swerved toward him. Kicking the opposite rudder, I avoided the collision, but by the time I got straightened out, I didn't have enough speed or runway to get airborne. I cut the switches and held the stick in my cut and closed my eyes. The plane ran off the field, across a sunken road which sheared off the gear, dropped two full wing tanks and skidded across the field, tore off the left wing on a stump, and wound up with its nose in a chicken coop. I was told later that I killed a crow in a hedge along the road and two chickens in the coop. That Mustang was rugged. I didn't even get a scratch.
We're clear of the earth. Let go of the brakes. She starts rolling. Have to break a little bit. The great thing about the Mustang is it was blessed with ingenious tailwheel steering. It is a system that was very much unlike most of the World War II fighters. You pull the stick in your stomach and the tailwheel steering engages and the thing just steers beautifully. You push it forward, it unlocks the tailwheel, and you can go full swivel for tight maneuvering. So you don't need very much brake in this. You can just push the runway out from the runway a bit, get the steering engaged, and it is a wonderful thing. Taxiing is a different in a tailwheel airplane, in a tailwheel fighter, but particularly in a tailwheel fighter, because the nose sticks way up out front. You can't see. You cannot see what's in front of you. So you've got to continually S-turn down the taxiway to see what you're looking at. And you get the nose out of the way, look out the side, take a look, yep, that looks clear. Then you can't go off the taxiway, so you come back the other way and look out this side. And it sort of looks like a drunk weed, but it's got its purpose to it, and it's something you have to do. And if you don't do it, you're gonna hit something sometime. We've seen fighters chew up airplanes. I saw T-6 once chew up a Cessna 150. Just took the tail right off. Hardly hurt the T-6, but it sure did chew up the 150. Coolant temperature's looking really good now. We're up to about 60 degrees, which is the red line on coolant. They're going as climbing towards 70. The oil is still below 40 degrees centigrade, so we still can't do anything. We've got to sit here and warm up. Once the cool temperature goes above 100, you better be quick, because the needle can rapidly move to the 125 degree red line. With some modern radiators, we've been able to push that another 5 or 10 degrees higher. But if you get so close and the coolant begins to overheat, you only got two options. You point it back in the wind, go to 1500 RPM, open the coolant door full open, and that'll give you enough air through the radiator, hopefully, to cool it down. If that doesn't work, all you can do is shut it down, because what you're going to get before too much longer is an expansion plug pop, which pops up in front of the header tank, and the airplane then looks like a Stanley steamer. And all you can do is shut down and reset the system and wait till it cools off. But today I don't think we're going to have that problem. It's very cool outside. The coolant's just slowly creeping up, and the oil seems to be creeping up slowly. So we won't have that problem. We've got our minimum temperatures now. We'll go right on up to 2300 RPM for run-up. And the incredible thing about this is this isn't even cruise power, and it really sounds like we're going. The power goes way up. Sounds like it's going way up. It's really not. We'll go right up to 2300 RPM. We cycle the propeller. Cycle it again. We have warm oil up in the dome. Check the magnetos. Right. Both. Left. Both. They're in limit. Everything looks in the green. Bring the power right on back. But that's just an engine run-up. That's not full power in the airplane. It always surprises a new Mustang pilot to do that, because it sounds like the world's coming to an end. It's really not. Go through the before takeoff checklist. Harness locked. Boost pump on. Altimeter set. Canopy locked. Oil door we'll put into automatic. We'll leave the coolant door in manual full open. Trim set. A fuel selector on the left main. Mainly because the carburetor feeds about 10 gallons an hour back into the left tank. It's a vent overflow, and if you have it on the right tank and forget, leave it take off, you will vent the fuel out. So you can actually lose gas and not know you're doing it just because it's venting the extra overflow out. Then you double check something very important, and that's the last thing here, other than rechecking the boost pump being on, is throttle friction set. Now, I remember the first time I ever took off with the throttle friction loose. I came up on the power, everything was looking good, got airborne and let go of it to bring the gear up, and I reached out for the gear handle, and the throttle drifted back to about 20 inches. I thought I'd lost the engine. I thought I was going to go in. I came back on the power, brought it back up, and then I finally found out what it was. Well, you can't let go of the throttle until you get enough altitude to lose the power, reset the friction, and bring the power back up so it stays set. You want to double check that every time. Well, there's nothing left to do but fly, so let's get some permission to take off, and all this adrenaline bouncing around inside, we better fly. So I can get rid of some of it. And here comes the real decision-making point, because really in truth, you either like flying single-seat fighters or you don't. And it's not everybody's cup of tea. You're in here by yourself with thousands of horsepower. It's an older airplane. It's a fighter pilot environment where you make all the decisions. Some people don't like it. Some people want multi-seat flying. Others thrive on single seats. Myself, I love single-seat flying. I think it's just terrific. So pull out on the runway, and the interesting thing about this is you pull out and then the runway disappears again. You cannot see. So the key is to keep your feet moving on takeoff. Don't let the tail fly up too soon. Otherwise, that big gyroscope out front does make a difference. Here we go, up on the power. Thank you. to watch for on takeoff is to make sure that you don't let the airplane get away from you with the torque. Now, it's not impossible to handle, but the key really is making sure that you don't let the tail fly out your fin, because if you do, the torque will pull it to the left and there's not enough rudder to steer it. The tail wheel steering should be left on as long as you can. And then once you do get airborne, and you pull the gear handle up, you want one motion on the gear handle. If you don't, you go in between, you can actually get the gear sequencer out of whack. And if you do that, what happens is you can actually have the wheels going up and down at different points, or the gear doors, the fairing doors on the inside stay up, and the wheels will hit the outside of the doors, and it gets all crazy. No matter what you do, the wheels will come, just don't seem to want to straighten out. What you do is you pull the hydraulic dump handle, dump all the pressure, let the wheels fall down normally, lock into place, then you start again. We'll make successive power reductions here, back to 36 inches at 2400 RPM. And that gives you a leisurely climb out. Not using a lot of fuel. Very easy. To be sort of fingertip control. It's not. It's very much a hands-on airplane. You can see why in World War II, these 18-year-old guys had to horse it around.
Knowing that we are now headed out for the real thing for the first time is beyond description. We circle the field to get everyone into set course formation. It's a beautiful sunny day with about 3/10 clouds at about 8,000 feet. It's a great feeling to look around the formation, knowing who is in each plane, guys you've flown with and lived with in the States, and now together doing the job you were trained for and in the airplane you had hoped to fly. Crossing out over the North Sea, Colonel Hayes calls, "Oilskin, feet are wet." I know that a lot of us are taking a last look at the beautiful green English countryside, knowing that this will be our home from now on. We climb steadily up to 20,000 feet. Up ahead, I can see the French and Belgian coast. We make landfall near Dunkirk. I've read enough about that place. The sky is clear and blue. The land below looks so green and peaceful with those scattered, puffy clouds. Then wham, bang, it's black at 7 o'clock. There it is for the first time. It doesn't look dangerous, it just appears like magic. Black and umbrella shaped. We make some evasive turns and nothing really comes close to us. But I really get a stab of excitement each time I hear that call of black.
Contrary to popular legend, the Mustang was not a maneuverable airplane. It was fine, but it was not a Spitfire. It was not a very light airplane. It had to fly 600 miles into Germany, and quite often it was a compromise. But the airplane is very smooth and very, very positive. It is not a difficult airplane to fly, and the controls are not excessively stiff. It's more like flying a Rolls-Royce than a Maserati. That's about the only way I know to describe it. There's a great deal of difference. One is very skittish and one's very smooth. And I'd say, of all the airplanes, the Mustang is probably the Rolls-Royce of the bunch. It's the Cadillac. The other airplanes that give similar feel, the P-47 and Corsair, and those with a R-2800 engine, probably the smoothest engine ever built. The Merlin is a little more noisy, a little more, has a little more vibration. V-12, surprisingly, is not running smooth as a 18-cylinder radial, but it's still a delightful engine and a wonderful angle. Always dreamed one day that maybe I'd slip back in time and get paid to do this.
On the Berlin raid of May 30th, 1944, my ship took 3 20-millimeter hits from a 109. After recovering from a violent spin, I found that on the left side there was only a hole about the size of a golf ball on the leading edge of the horizontal stabilizer. On the right side, the wingtip was missing. With the extra drag from the damaged wing plus normal torque from the prop, I had to apply full left aileron trim and fly with the stick as far to the left as it would go. When I got back a little altitude and things settled down, I let go of the stick to see what would happen. Before I could blink, the ship did the most vicious snap pull I ever experienced. I brought her in, wheels down, without incident. As I taxied back, everyone was looking, surprisingly not at the wing, but at the tail. When I stopped at my hard stand, I found out why. All the movable surface of the left horizontal stabilizer was gone. The leading edge with the hole in it was practically all that was left. The third 20-millimeter shell that hit the ship was the scariest. At 109, it was swinging from left to right while it was firing. The first one took the stabilizer. The third hit the wing and made it spin. When he fired the second one, he was dead astern. It left a 2-foot crease along the fuselage, directly below the right side of the cockpit, and did not detonate. August 13th, 1944 was my most satisfying mission because it proved to me the value of operating by the book. As a countermeasure to Jerry's strafing the front lines at dusk to minimize interference by our fighters, we began patrolling the front every evening. On this date, we had 8 ships up and spotted 10 plus 109s heading east on the deck. I lined up behind one that seemed to be a leader. As we came into range, my mind suddenly filled with everything I had ever learned and practiced for such a situation. Wait until those wingtips fill the ring sight. You're a little above him. Pull the paper out a bit in front of his nose. Check the needle and ball. You don't want to be skidding. I squeeze the trigger, and immediately everything from the 50s converged on his engine. He rolled over and went in. His wingman must have been surprised. I gave him a short burst. I guess the tracers passing over his wings was too much. He immediately jettisoned the canopy and bailed out. I circled as he floated down, and when he landed, he calmly pulled in his chute, tucked it under his arm, and waved and walked away. The 8 of us destroyed 8 and damaged 3, the best day this squadron ever had.
I loved that airplane. Reactions to a woman climbing out of a P-51 during the war were varied, mostly startled. I wouldn't have cared what anyone said as long as they let me fly it. Once I flew into a field that was off limits, but the weather was bad and I had a slight mechanical problem, so I called in and I asked for permission to land. I kept radioing, P-51, ready to land, awaiting final landing instructions. It was sort of garbled, and they kept asking me to call in again and again. Finally, they said, waggle your wings if you receive. So there I was, waggling away, and pretty soon they came back, lady, the only thing we see up there is a P-51. Where are you? I replied, that's me. I am the P-51. They couldn't believe it. They were looking for a Piper Cub or something. Finally, when I landed, what a welcome I got. Word got around that a gal was flying that thing. They were darlings. By the time I had taxied up to the line, following that little follow me truck, there were a lot of guys around to see what kind of a woman was flying this P-51. They'd never heard of us, the Wasps.
One of the unusual things about the Mustang is its lack of emergency systems. Very simply, there aren't any. If the engine quits, maintain a best glide speed at 175 miles an hour and pick the best spot. Though fighters have a reputation for coming down like a brick, most have excellent glide ratios, far better than the average general aviation aircraft. For example, from 10,000 feet, you can glide 29 statute miles. That's a healthy 3 miles per 1,000 feet of descent. However, those miles really slide by at 175, so you have to react quickly.
that view up the front. There is nothing like the view out of a fighter. And we're heading back to the airport now. Looking right down the nose is a thrilling sight. But it gets kind of captured by that. This airplane will go 300 miles an hour just with the nose slightly down. So you have to pre-plan your descent into an airport. If you don't plan long ahead of time what you're going to do, you could have come by the airport 300 miles an hour way too high. You can't land. So it's a pre-planning airplane. It's a fighter plane. It is not your regular, everyday, don't have budget of regular airplane. The flaps can be used as air brakes, but you really don't want to have to be using flaps all the time if you can help it. We're going to make a 360-degree overhead approach, no standard military approach. And what that allows us to do is come into the airport at about 250 miles an hour, and if we lose an engine, we'll make the runway. It's a very safe approach. And we'll report initial, and then do the break over the airport.
Ground personnel were gleeful targets for playful pilots, and more than once I hit the sod or dove off my bike as a P-51 streaked down the perimeter track at close to 400 miles per hour, with the prop tips only about a foot above the asphalt. I remember once, as we got up and were dusting ourselves off, someone said, "Good God, did you notice? We were looking down on top of his wing." Another time, I was on my bike in an exposed area on the perimeter when I saw this guy coming at me in a long power dive. I thought it was for scaring the hell out of me, but I guess he didn't have that in mind, because he passed at a respectable distance. You know, it's strange, but those buzz jobs remain among my fondest memories of those days. It was pure envy.
Ground 77, spare the active taxi
Flying fighters is one of those dreams people have when they think about life's ultimate experiences. Shutting down a Merlin brings the realization that the dreams come true. When I was learning to fly, I looked down a long tunnel toward what I really wanted to fly, and there sat the P-51, along with a couple of other dream machines. It really does fly as good as it looks, and it was a privilege to bring you with me. I look forward to having you along for the next Roaring Glory.